Hello and welcome. First presentation of the work elaborated by experts or faculty members begin with Dr. Matnu Verma.
Can I start?
Dr. Matnu Verma is Chief Economist, World Resources Institute from India. And she will present us ecosystem services from mountain ecosystems. Dear madam, the floor is yours.
Can you please unshare your screen so that my screen gets visible?
Please share your screen.
You have to unshare yours first, then I can share.
I stopped mine.
Thank you. Thank you. I got it. So thank you very much, first of all, Hasra, for inviting me to this wonderful session. And this has been my area of passion, I would say. I've been passionately working for mountain ecosystems all my life, and very happy to share my experience, my work, and also to learn from all of you sitting in this very, very useful program. So as I'm given to speak on this particular topic, and basically I'll start with some keywords. Of course, the presentation is a bit long. I would touch upon a few things which I would like to highlight. And I made it purposely long so that you can have this presentation with you and you can go through to understand various aspects and issues pertaining to mountain ecosystems and what we are doing, what we do in terms of ecosystem services, their valuation, environmental accounting, and ultimately taking these values forward in terms of creating payment for ecosystem services. So basically, ecosystem services are the benefits provided by the functioning ecosystems. We say the dead ecosystems don't give you anything. So the ecosystems have to be thriving, should be functioning, should be multiplying themselves, should be providing, you know, services. So they help, you know, for people's health, jobs, and safety. Valuation is a process which, you know, assigns value, you know, either monetary, biophysical, or qualitative aspect of these ecosystem services, just to understand what is the worth of these ecosystem services. Then we take this particular system forward or the assessment forward in a very structured fashion or on a framework called as environmental accounting, developed by nations. Division of environmental statistics and accounting, and we provides you what is the contribution that natural resources are making towards the economic well-being, what is the ecological contribution, economic contribution of these ecosystems, and they help, you know, not just providing these benefits, they also help in, you know, reducing pollution, but at the same time subjected to, because of high economic development, subjected to pollution and resource degradation. Ultimately, we take all these values forward. And for example, you work out the value of water provisioning. So what should be the charge on provisioning of water? So we work out so-called payment for ecosystem services. It is in process, it is in transit. Not all ecosystem services are being marketed and charged for. They're available free right now to us. But now we've realized the importance of these ecosystem services, especially after COVID. You know, we get to understand what is the value of oxygen, because we have to pay heavily for seeking oxygen cylinder, for saving lives in COVID. Similarly, it accounts for all other ecosystem services. Well, we have been discussing about mountain ecosystems. I'm not going to details, but it is a very complex living organisms in mountain areas, provide scattered but diverse area of habitats in which a large range of plants and animals can be found. At high altitude areas, they have, you know, and especially I'm talking about the region I come from, India, and I look at the entire, you know, Hindu Kush Himalayan region. So mountain land occurs, in highest area of mountain land occurs in the Himalayas in this particular region, and comprises 13 Indian states and a couple of, you know, international boundaries also covered into it. Well, we have a huge dependence of these areas, of, you know, people's livelihood on these areas. For 51 million people who practice hill agriculture remain still very vulnerable because of facing the vagaries of climate change, and, you know, natural disasters happening in these regions. They spread across a larger region. So what is, you know, important is they provide for huge, you know, diversity of mammals, birds, fishes, reptiles, and they provide huge amount of ecological security to Indian landmass, definitely, because they get so much support, so much supply, so many rivers originate from them, so many drinking water facilities you get because rivers are there, irrigation happens, and then also hydropower, conserving biodiversity, all these things also happen in this region.
Professor, please, it's a require from Poonam Sah. She requests to speak you slowly.
Okay, sure.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for reminding me. So if you look at specifically what these mountain ecosystems provide, they provide key livelihood resources such as food, timber, fiber, and medicine. Besides these visible so-called outcomes or resources or benefits, we get wide range of other ecosystem services, which are not so much visible to us. And we don't know what is happening behind the curtain. And they're so much helpful to us in terms of fresh air and water, climate regulation, carbon storage, maintenance of aesthetic and cultural spiritual values. So these are the range of ecosystem services you get from mountain ecosystems, especially Himalayas I'm talking about. And similarly, to conserve these areas, we have got under the National Action Plan for Climate Change, a special mission for sustaining the Himalayan ecosystem. It is one of the 8 missions that we have under NAFCC. We also have Indian Himalayan Central University Consortium. It is such an important area to work, to be looked after, to be conserved, to be taken care of, that huge amount of research goes into, you know, system, and it provides, you know, a kind of a feedback, kind of interventions to be made for conserving these areas. So basically it tries to do enumeration and valuation of economic impact of female labor in the hills, because this is a kind of category, I would say, that they face a lot of drudgery, because it is so happening in Himalayan region that large male population migrates to other urban areas, or they go to different services. So it is the women who look after these, you know, land basically. And it has agroecology in the Himalayan states with special emphasis on marketing is required, development of eco-friendly and cost-effective tourism in hills, that's what Indian Himalayan University has to provide. Opportunities for livelihood check and migration, so sort of some interventions that they provide to us. Now, if you look at these services in details, we have a provisioning service, which is nothing but, you know, in terms of what we, material things that we get from these ecosystems in terms of food, fiber, genetic resources, biochemicals, fresh water. They're the goods provided by the ecosystems. If you go further, we get livestock in these regions, capture fisheries, aquaculture, wild foods, timber, cotton, hemp silk, wood fuel, like that. If you look at, you know, the so-called regulating services, they are the ones you get from the system, which controls, you know, the flow of services as such, in terms of air quality regulation, climate regulation, global carbon dioxide sequestration at regional local level as well. At this level, you look at erosion control, water purification, disease regulation, pest regulation, pollination, natural hazard regulation are the regional and local services provided. And we get a lot of, you know, regulation in terms of GHG emissions and carbon dioxide sequestration at the international or the global level. The services which are gaining a lot of importance these days, and I happen to be part of these international, you know, assessment reports, like the first one, not the first one, but one of the major ones which came out in 2005, the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment, which gave this kind of classification. It produced a kind of a health card of ecosystems to understand what is to be done, what is the status of these ecosystems. And then we developed an economic aspect of it in the Ecosystems of Economics and Biodiversity, the TEEB report in 2009. The special TEEB reports came into being for agriculture, for fisheries, for many other such sectors, for cities, for climate change, and there's huge work going on. Right now, I'm engaged in a huge work on a flagship study of my institute called as a study on doubling farmers' income in India using agroecological approaches. I'm very happy to see Professor Simona is specializing in this domain. I'll be very happy to connect with you rather after the session. So, and then I worked in the current, you know, process called as Intergovernmental Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Service, the IBBES process, which gave a biodiversity assessment report in 2019. And it's an eye-opener for everybody that what we have lost in the past. And they realized that we have lost the system of our own indigenous systems of conserving resources. So it has given a huge stress on cultural services, the non-material benefits obtained from ecosystems, and the indigenous knowledge systems. So it is greatly giving a lot of emphasis on spiritual and religious values which come on account of ecosystems. we have huge knowledge system. It is a repository of, you know, activities, repository of resources. You get to understand this as well. Educational values, you get inspiration from nature. Aesthetic value, look at the beauty of nature. Because of good resources availability, you have good social relations, otherwise you fight over resources. Sense of place, I take pride in saying I'm from Bhopal, I'm from Delhi, and I'm from the city of lakes, I'm from country of tigers, so this is a sense of place you get. And recreation and ecotourism, which is going to be talked about a lot in this coming session. What is behind the curtain activity is the sort of supporting services. They are these functions that maintain all services in terms of primary production process, nutrient cycling, soil formation. So this is what happens and gives you the area of provisioning, cultural and regulating services. So if I look at, for example, forest ecosystem, which is one of the major mountain ecosystem, it is not just timber and non-wood forest produce that you get from these forests and a bit of ecotourism, but the whole area of service, which you can see here, come into being in the system. In fact, there's a very interesting tree diagram from FAO, which shows a single tree and many trees will constitute forest. We have a typical definition of forest. It provides so many things to us. If you fell a tree, not just you lose timber, you lose some NTFPs or some leaves and foliage and biomass, but the whole number of plant products get lost, whole number of, you know, services functions which get lost, whole number of, you know, the habitat for many such, you know, insects, birds, animals also get lost. So you must look at from this particular angle. And these ecosystems provide such, you know, huge amount of these services and trees. So ecosystems, also the services, they're like capital assets. Just as you invest money in, you know, human capital, physical capital, financial capital, social capital, it's very important to invest, you know, money or make investments or have budgets for conserving nature, because it is nature which provides you everything. If nature is gone, you are also gone. So it's a strong connect exists. So it makes sense to invest in, you know, nature conservation, because it's a kind of a capital asset. And these ecosystems, mountain ecosystems, provide huge amount of these services. And these services have a strong linkage to our, you know, own security, basic material for good life, our own health, our good social relations, which I talked about. And we have a lot of choices to make. You know, just we are competing for one, there are lots of things available for us. As per our interest, choice, dependence, our, you know, requirement, we can, you know, extract this money. The strong linkage, which is shown by the dark lines, and some less effective linkages, less prominent linkages shown by the light lines. This is what the dependence is there. So the tea process gave a very interesting exposure to ecosystem services and its valuation and how it should go in the process. What I said in the very beginning, my second slide, the first effort for any ecosystem, you know, to recognize its value, what it provides to you. List down the whole set of ecosystems services that you get, which are shown by these symbols here, which are the tea symbols. Then having done the identification and the physical, we have to do the physical estimation to demonstrate the value. What quantity of water is flown from Himalayan ecosystems? What is the capture of carbon? How much nutrient cycling is being done? How much pollination service is being done? How much wood is being made available? So we do that. We demonstrate by economic terms and whether one likes it or not. All the policymakers, decision makers likes the language of numbers very much. They understand that language the best. Any amount of textual information will not provide them many that kind of knowledge. The moment you start telling, this is the quantum of availability, or this is what you have lost because of degradation, this is the value of provisioning of a particular service, this much investment has gone or will be required, they would understand this language very well. That's what I had done all my life. And then finally, capturing these values in the formal system of ecosystem accounting. In our GNP estimates, we don't account for these invisible contributions. Nature has provisioned us a lot of invisible services, which you need to make visible by accounting, by valuing them, by accounting them in the system, and then take them forward by creating a whole set of ecosystems, instruments for ecosystem services. So IPBES gave us a very interesting diagram. It changed the whole classification of ecosystem services rather than nomenclature. And I happened to be part of the chapter which was written in the report on nature's contribution to people. If I say ecosystem services, which is a bit technical term, not many people would understand. But if I say they're nothing but they're contributing to people, they're nature's contribution to people, then people can connect and then you can engage in a participatory way, all sorts of stakeholders to conserve nature. This is what happens, you know, at local, regional and at the international level. So in fact, there's a very recently only IUCN conference has accomplished, was accomplished in France. and they had a focus on what is called as nature-based solutions. We have lots of problems, you know, across the region. For example, if a problem of emissions and carbon or carbon emissions, and these ecosystems will do carbon sequestration. You have your pollution, and many such things are sequestered by, for example, river systems and these ecosystems. You require habitat, and you are naturally provided by, you know, these ecosystems. So we have a lot of nature-based solutions associated with these ecosystems. And they also help us, and you know, we are aware that the next decade, starting from this particular year to 2030, is a UN decade of ecosystem restoration. Because we have realized that a couple of reports, not just IPBES, IPCC, many of the reports have highlighted the reasoning for conserving these, you know, resources, and you have to restore what has degraded. It is a decade of restoration, and what it provides to you, you can see what I've just presented in my slides. When these systems thrive, you get these services, and systems degrade, you lose all these services. So you have to reimagine, recreate, restore these ecosystems, and they have strong linkages with what we have to achieve in 2030, also the sustainable development goals. Our NDC targets are also in front of us. So that's what they support, is a couple of SDGs and a couple of, you know, NDC targets. This is a whole, I would say, a few reports which I have done, being in the previous institution of Institute of Forest Management, which has been mentioned about. And we did a lot of work on valuing these resources, and having joined WRI, working exclusively on agroecological systems and writing a lot across, you know, and we talked about, these are some of the papers which PNAS published and Nature Systems got published, many op-eds we published in due course of time. This is what, you know, kind of system I'm talking about. You identify ecosystem services, you take out the set of indicators which will use to estimate the ecosystem services quantum, physical estimation, do monetary, green accounting, and create the instruments. So this is what is the list of services that you can see, and you divide them into two categories, the flow benefits and the stock benefits. Like, not everything gets available always, you know, few things are there which will restrict availability of other services. There's a kind of compatibility to be there, exists in amongst ecosystem services also. Like, if you're felling trees, if you go for tree felling, then you cannot get water purification done, or you cannot get gene pool protection done, you cannot get soil conservation done. But if you have protection of a tree, it also renders many other functions at the same time. It sequesters, you know, carbon, it conserves water, it conserves soil, it provides nursery function, it provides, you know, recreation, waste assimilation. So what remains there always is the stock value, which is because you just as you have a stock of something and then you take it out, which becomes flow value. Similarly, it stores carbon as well. So these two are the storage stock values. The rest are all available every year from these ecosystems. I'm just taking example of forest ecosystem. So you get them available. What is most challenging in ecosystem services valuation, which is this session is all about, is to identify an indicator, then use a methodology to capture the value. Then only you can convert them into monetary, or if not monetary, non-monetary qualitative, you know, values to explain, but do a biophysical modeling if you're able to get the physical values and explain that. For example, for employment generation, we use number of mandates generated. If you have agriculture happening in that area, value of agriculture produced, fishing, value of fish catch, because you conserve the upstream, you know, ecosystem, the downstream area also gets benefited. Fuel wood, how much fuel wood is coming out, you do the quantity of fuel wood collected, like that you go on. For carbon sequestration, the growing stock value, water provisioning, it is indirectly getting parked either in agriculture production, in water recharge, in domestic uses, and maybe industrial usage. Water purification, you are avoiding water purification cost, otherwise you would have spent if the water contaminated. Similarly, for soil conservation, this goes on, you know, you get this by using a specific indicator and we capture these benefits. I'll just quickly run through some examples to show you, to demonstrate how these values estimation was used to influence decision makers, the policy makers. That is the end use of your entire effort and work, because it must influence the so-called stakeholders. And accordingly, policies, institutions, markets should be created, altered, or strengthened, augmented, such that you have effective, you know, sustainable management of these resources on ground. And when you manage these resources sustainably, the nature is sustained, then your economy is also sustained. There's a huge linkage exists between ecological security and the so-called livelihood security, the security of the economy. So you need to maintain these resources very well. We did a study for Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change to work out the value of diversion of forest. Like till 1999, there was a thumb rule used if you are asking for diversion of forest for non-forestry purposes, like maybe construction of roads, hydropower dam projects, laying down power lines and construction of railway lines and so forth, mining as well. So there was a thumb rule of just charging for value of timber, that too with a local market estimation, and some NTFP in assessment was thumb rule was used. I did a study in 1999-2000 for Himachal Pradesh and Himalayan state of India, and looked at the entire area of these ecosystem services, used methods and used previously done studies to borrow values, and I came up with a very huge number. What was this 5% contribution to the GDP became 90% contribution to GDP because the forest provides so much to you. So influenced by that, Supreme Court set up a committee and we worked for the committee to give these values. And values in the range of 4.38 lakhs to 10.43 lakhs per hectare. This is the Indian currency. We can convert them into dollars as well. I should have rather forgot to do that. Again, 6 eco classes and 3 density classes. We revised these values because after almost 10 years, 12 years time, the methodology changed, the data sets changed, and more knowledge, and we got the value in the range of 5.65 to 55.55 lakh per hectare across 14 forest types and 4 density classes, but it is yet to be effected on ground. But it just did lead to a couple of things happen. The National Green Tribunal of the country used these values, and we also added what is called as possession value of land. When you divert forest, forest is gone, but the land also, which you had possessed earlier, is gone. And there was no value charge, a very minimal, 10,000 per hectare was charged for land, which is a huge value. Forest located in the heart of a city, for example, will have more land value than the value of its ecosystem services from standing forest. That got affected from NGT since 2017 in Indian economy. We did huge work on tiger conservation, the habitat conservation, and its valuation rather. What the habitat conservation gives you, a habitat of tiger. If you want to protect tiger, protect its habitat. So this was launched by the then minister in 2015, the first report. Second report was launched by our honorable prime minister in 2019. So this is the array of services which we got. There's not much time, I just put in these services. You get, if you just look at these, the dark ones, the purple ones are the stock values, these are the flow values. And what we found very interesting is the return on investment in these tiger reserves. If you invest a rupee and we looked at the management cost, and what is the area of ecosystem services coming out of these ecosystems, these tiger reserves? We simply did a simple calculation, found a huge return on investment happens in these tiger reserves. No other portfolio I can challenge will give you that much amount of return. Similarly, another Himalayan state we worked for was Uttarakhand in the northern Himalayan region, a report on green accounting and developing framework for, this is for forest resources, and we developed a framework for other resources as well, launched by the then chief minister of the state. So we also found, we found the huge change in the, we did all these, forest, water, soil, topography, minerals, we studied across the state. We used 21 ecosystem services to capture these values. Of course, methods were used to work it out. What we found, what was a very minimal value estimation and contribution shown in the state domestic product increased to 95,000 crores in Indian currency. So, which is a huge amount of money which you actually provide, but you get in exchange a very minimal amount of budget. It so happens all over the world, you always look at your GDP estimates. More you contribute, more you get in exchange as your budgets to maintain the resource for future. But it is an irony in forestry sector in India. To give this example, we have a huge target of maintaining 33% of our area under forest and tree cover, but the budget given is not even 1% of the total budget. How can you achieve that target? This is first thing. Secondly, the huge dependence of populations on forest. You have to make this sector thriving. You have to engage people in conservation such that they can get benefit on account of their own efforts, not for themselves, but for this economy as a whole. So this was an eye-opener for the government to do this. And now the intent to work out the gross ecosystem product of all other sectors as well, which I showed you in my previous slide, has to be done for all of them across the globe, which we just try to work out in our study. So this is what we have done. Ultimately, we have to work out what is called as gross ecosystem product using the value of ecosystem services. We have just worked out a structure out of the reports which are being done by the Nation Statistical Division on System of Environmental Economic Accounting. Their frameworks for environmental flows, natural resources, environmental transactions, ecosystem assets and services. And it is now finally endorsed by UN as a standard to be followed by all countries across the globe. So we have, we can create accounts of forest, biodiversity, land, water, energy, look at all these accounts. We create ecosystem extent account. What is the spread of an ecosystem? In what condition it is? It is healthy, it is unhealthy, it is degraded, it is thriving, like that. Then we work with supply and use table, what you get out of it. We do monetary accounting. Before that, we also do mapping of ecosystem services, biophysical assessment, we do the evaluation. And ultimately we get, you know, ecosystem service product. Now, China is one of the first country in the world which has developed the gross ecosystem product accounting for eco-compensation and pushing GEP application in China across 16 provinces. And that's what everybody in the world has to take forward. And we are also making an effort in India to take this forward. That's what you can see. So this is the current actual contribution by, you know, flow values of 95,000 crores in Uttarakhand state. What is shown right now is very small amount of it. It is, in fact, huge difference. Just 1.5%, when you change this, it becomes a huge value of contribution. So this is being widely quoted. The work that we had done is wanted to show how important it is, how much importance is gaining these days in the eyes of, you know, stakeholders. It got through across, you know, leading newspaper. We also worked with the Finance Commission of India to work out a compensation, like what I talked about in the beginning, was in net present value for forest diversion. But when forest is conserved, there should be a compensation. We worked with the Finance Commission and worked out these kinds of values, maintenance costs, restoration costs, high conservation value forest indicators, developed a conservation cost index, high conservation value index, and worked out a kind of a formula through which the allocation should be made. What you lose by conservation, we also demonstrated. And ultimately, the 14th Finance Commission, way back in five years ago, effected on the basis of the study that we have done, provided into the formula weightage to the forest cover, 7.5%. And huge amount of money, which was a very small amount as a grant, flew towards forestry sector from center to state. Now this is increased to 10%, keeping in mind the entire aspect of climate change and the sea targets, and also, you know, management of sector as a whole for provisioning of the economic systems. This is what, you know, I just wanted to show, run through to give you an idea about what is the relevance of, you know, actually assessing these ecosystem services, doing their evaluation, and trying to provide a value which will help policymakers, stakeholders to take rightful decision and sustainably manage these resources. Thank you so much for this opportunity. Any questions, I'll be very happy to answer.
Thank you very much, Professor, for your excellent presentation. The questions will address you on chat. Next,